change, what will change? All of my life you've got, Jesus Christ, you took all my pain, you took all my shame. Now I'm gonna live again, good God, I've broken the chains, broken the chains. All of my life you've got, Jesus, you took all my pain, you took all my shame. Now I'm gonna live again.
A VIP card, they should be in the seat back in front of you, and put it in the offering when it comes around. This is just our way to get to know you and contact you if you're interested in doing anything or getting involved in the church.
I'm so glad to see all my church family here today. We just had a big event this past Friday. It was a young couples gathering. We had a lot of fun. We have a lot of ways to get connected here at our church, and tons of ways to get plugged into the community and your peers and fellow worshipers around you. And if you would, turn your attention to the screen, and you can find out all the ways to get involved in our church.
Hi, I'm Mike Lampkin, and this is Happening Now, your source for news and upcoming events at the Palace of Praise. It is our vision here at the Palace of Praise that everyone get connected with ministry and purpose. Here are a few events and opportunities to get connected this week. On Sunday, April 10th, there will be a Showers and Flowers Sunday Night Fellowship in the Metro at 6 p.m. As always, there'll be delicious food with lots of fun and fellowship. It's a great chance to get to know the family a little bit better. Donations will be accepted at the food tables. All proceeds will go to help produce Kids Fest 2016. We hope to see you all there. We will have a baptism for new converts or any wanting to renew their baptism experience on Sunday, April 17th at 6 p.m. All candidates must be in room 102 at 5:45 to give a name tag and instructions. Please remember to bring a change of clothing. For the older teenagers in the family, there will be a teenagers potluck on Friday, April 21st at 6 p.m. in the Metro. Briskets, rolls, and drinks are provided. Please bring a dish and come join in the fun. If you're interested in becoming a member of the Palace family, there'll be a membership service on April 26th at 6 p.m. All membership candidates should meet in room 102 at 5 p.m. The 2016 Palace of Praise Golf Tournament is on Saturday, April 23rd. This tournament is a shotgun start at 8 a.m. Please bring either cash or check, and please pay me the course of that morning. We still have room for a few more teams. For more information, you can contact me at mike@palaceofpraise.com. We'll be having a special communion service on Sunday morning, April 24th. Please invite a friend or family member to this service. We'll be recognizing our 2016 high school graduates on Sunday, May 1st in the AM service. If you're a graduating senior or a parent of one, please sign up at the registration desk in the foyer by Sunday, May 17th. Please mark your calendars and save the date for our annual Mother's Day service on Sunday, May 8th. During this special service, we will be honoring our mothers and grandmothers. If she doesn't already attend, please invite your mom to attend this service with you. The Men's Ministry will be hosting a Conceal and Carry course with instructor Jim Akers in the Metro Cafe on April 15th. The course will begin at 6 p.m. Range Day will follow on April 16th with the time to be announced. All interested should sign up in the foyer. If you have a question, please contact Bob Bennett. We have a limited supply of Palace of Praise t-shirts or polos for sale right now in the foyer. This is an inventory clearance sale to clear out the rest of the existing shirts. We have limited selection of sizes available for half price. Again, this is a limited supply of t-shirts for half price. If you don't have your Palace shirt, now is the time to get one. Get them in the foyer today after the service. Following the morning service, there's going to be a children's pastor parent meeting in the Metro for all wanting their children to attend Missouri Church of God Camp 2016. Please make every effort to be at this meeting, as information on cost, dates, fundraising, and more will be given during this time. Thanks for watching. I'm Mike, and this has been Happening Now. Find your ministry and go get connected.
Who can find a virtuous woman? Her price is far above rubies. Proverbs 31:10. You are invited to Girlfriend Connection on Friday, April 29th. Doors open at 5 p.m. Dinner will be served in the Metro from 5:30 p.m. through 6:30 p.m. Vendor booths will be open in the main foyer from 5 p.m. to 6:30 p.m. Pre-service fun begins in the main sanctuary at 6:45 p.m. Worship in the Word by Michelle Davenport from LaGrange, Georgia will begin at 7 p.m. Child care for newborn to 10 years old will be provided from 6:30 p.m. to 9 p.m. Register now at the ladies' table in the foyer.
Worship you, for you say that you inhabit the praises of your people. And God, I just ask that lives be changed this morning, that your presence be felt. And God, I ask that you to anoint the pastor to speak the word of truth. I ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.
If the elders would come. In James chapter 5, verse 14, said that if there's any sick among you, let him call on the elders of the church, and let them pray over him, anointing him with oil in the name of the Lord. And the prayer of faith shall save the sick, and the Lord shall raise him up. And if you committed any sins, they shall be forgiven him. If you have a need this morning, I just ask that you make your way, and one of the elders will pray with you. Are you excited to be in the house of the Lord this morning? Come on, give him a shout of praise.
Glorious. Shout it out and loud, and Jesus, we shout your name. Jesus, we make your praise glorious. You are glorious. Oh, my God, you reign forever and ever. How great your name. Your love remains forever and ever. You stay the same. Come on, clap your hands. Shout it out, if you know he's good. Sing it out, for the Lord is good. Shout it out loud, you are glorious. Glorious. Shout it out and glorious. Make it loud and Jesus, we shout your name. Jesus, we make your praise.
Sing, my God.
My God, you reign forever and ever. How great your name. Your love remains forever and ever. You stay the same.
Shout it out.
Shout it out, shout it out. If you know he's good, sing it out, for the Lord is good. Shout it out loud, you are glorious.
Come on, sing.
Glorious. Shout it out and glorious. Make it loud and Jesus, we shout your name. Jesus, we make your praise glorious. You are glorious.
Ooh.
shine, Jesus. You shine for all the world to see. You are glorious. Come on, shine. Shine, Jesus. You shine for all the world to see. You are glorious. Shine.
Your name, Jesus, we make your praise glorious. You are glorious. Oh, 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 oh. God, you are glorious. Oh.
Church, you are glorious. You are glorious. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Come on, do you have the joy of the Lord this morning?
Celebration begin and make a
joyful noise unto him. Come on, everybody, let's give him praise, for he is good. Oh, you have given me a joy that won't stop and will never leave. So I will praise you with gladness, for you are good. Oh, you have given me a joy that won't stop and will never leave. So I will praise you with gladness, for you are good. You turn my sadness into gladness. You turn my sorrow into joy. And now I'm singing and I'm dancing, and I will shout for joy. You turn my sadness into gladness. You turn my sorrow into joy. And now I'm singing and I'm dancing, and I will shout for joy. Sing it again. My sadness into gladness. You turn my sorrow into joy. And now I'm singing, oh, and I'm dancing, and I will shout for joy. Oh, you have given me a joy that won't stop and will never leave. So I will praise you with gladness, for you are good. Oh, you have given me a joy that won't stop and will never leave. So I will praise you with gladness, for you are good. For you are good. For you are good. Oh, oh. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Hey, hallelujah. Praise you, Lord. Oh, we worship you, God.
You were just such a hands. Hallelujah.
Your presence.
the more I find you, and the more I find you, the more I love you. I wanna sit at your feet, drink from the cup in your hand, lay back against you and breathe, and feel your heart beat. This love is so deep, it's more than I can stand. I melt in your peace, it's overwhelming. The more I see you, the more I find you, the more I find you, yes, the more I love you. And I wanna sit at your feet, drink from the cup in your hand, lay back against you, your heart beats. This love is so deep, it's more than I can stand. I melt in your peace, it's overwhelming. I wanna sit at your feet, drink from the cup in your hand, lay back against you.
we feel your presence in this house. Wanna sit at your feet, drink from the cup in your hand, lay back against you and breathe, feel your heartbeat. This love is so deep, it's more than I can stand. I melt in your peace, it's overwhelming.
If you're hungry, be filled with Jesus today. If you just bow your heads with me, Lord, your spirit is in this place, God, and we thank you, Lord, that you are here and you're visiting us today, Lord Jesus. I pray those who are hungry, Lord, they will be filled. Lord, I pray your spirit would move, Lord, however you see fit, Lord Jesus, God, you would take control of the service, Lord, Father. God, there's someone in here today who is searching for something more. They know there's something more. And Lord, I pray today would be the day that they find you and never be thirsty again. And Lord, I just pray, God, that you would just bless this service, Lord. Speak through us, through our pastor today. Lord, bless this offering, Lord Jesus, in your name. Amen.
Praise the name of the Lord. I tell you, the presence of the Lord is very sweet in this house this morning. Hallelujah. You know, there's one thing that I've made a commitment to the Lord a long, long time ago. And that is that when I approach him, I don't want to approach him too casually and take him for granted. Because his presence is holy. If we could ever understand the holiness of God, we'd all just fall on our faces and hide them from him and cry out, holy, 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 Lord God Almighty, which is and which is to come. We'd be like the seraphims. So that's all we would do is just cry out, holy, holy, holy. His presence is so rich in here this morning, just so, so wonderful. If you have your Bibles, I want you to turn with me to the book of 1 Corinthians chapter 12. We're going to read two verses out of that. We're going to read the first verse and the last verse. And then I'm going to try to fill everything in between. Amen? No, we're not going to do that. We'll be here too long. There's 31 verses. 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 1 and verse 31. If you'd stand for the reading of the word, please. 1 Corinthians chapter 12, starting with verse 1. Now concerning spiritual gifts, brethren, I would not have you to be ignorant. Look at verse 31. But covet earnestly the best gifts, and yet show I unto you a more excellent way. I'm going to ask Brother Bob Fisher, one of our elders, to pray the blessing over the word this morning. I want to read the text one more time. Verse 1 says, now concerning spiritual gifts, brethren, I would not have you to be ignorant. And verse 31 again says, but covet earnestly the best gifts, and yet I will show unto you more an excellent way. Now, in chapter 12 of 1 Corinthians, we have what we call the instructions by the Apostle Paul concerning spiritual gifts and the use of them within the church and the body of Christ. We don't have time to cover the whole chapter, but I do want to talk this morning on what the Holy Spirit is focusing in on. The Holy Spirit has laid just something very basic on my heart. He's just given me just a little part of this chapter because there's no way that we can preach it all. But we don't have time to cover the whole chapter, but I do just want to speak those little things that the Spirit is saying to the congregation. Are you ready for them? If so, answer amen. Paul, in verse 1 of our text, makes it plain that he does not want us as the body of Christ to be ignorant concerning spiritual gifts. It is spiritual gifts. If spiritual gifts were lifted or no longer in operation, are unimportant to the body of Christ, then all Paul would have had to do is dismiss them all together, and he would have never had to teach or instruct us in those gifts. He makes it plain that he does not want us as a part of the body of Christ to be ignorant of those spiritual gifts and the workings or the operation of them in the body, which is the church. He says in the last verse of that chapter, in verse 31, he says, but covet earnestly the best gift, and then I will show you a more excellent way. He actually encourages the church to covet earnestly the best gifts. That's what he's telling you. That's what he's telling me. He's looking out over this congregation this morning, and he's saying, oh, palace of praise, I want you to covet the best gifts. I want you to desire them. The words covet and earnestly reveals that Paul wants us to have a holy ambition to discover and accept and to be available to be used by the Spirit of the living God in the gifts of the Spirit. This speaks that there ought to be a passionate desire of all believers, not just some believers, but all of us, for the gifts of the Spirit to be operating within our lives. How many of you want the gifts of the Holy Spirit at any given moment to start operating in your life? Raise your hand. Then you better get ready, because that's what God's calling this church to start doing. He's wanting us to start operating in the gifts of the Spirit. Paul actually wants the church to be in hot pursuit of these gifts and understand their importance. As a matter of fact, right now we have Pentecostal churches that do not allow the gifts of the Spirit to operate in it because of the confusion sometimes that they bring as a result of overzealousness. Instead of dealing with overzealousness, they just said the gifts ain't worth it at all. But I'm here to tell you that this pastor says not only are we going to allow the gifts of the Spirit to operate, but they're necessary and they're important for the body of the church to be able to flourish. Can I have an amen? Are you with me here this morning? Are we Pentecostal or are we not Pentecostal? Do we believe in the power of the Holy Spirit and the operation of the gifts in this 21st century? If you do, just stand to your feet and give the God the highest praise that he's about to pour these gifts out upon the church. Hallelujah. Yes. God, help us. Hallelujah. Paul actually, again, wants the church to be in hot pursuit of these gifts. He actually uses the word covet in order to describe the intensity of our desire that we are to have into seeking after those gifts. The Hebrew word used for covet in the Old Testament is one of the most powerful words that there is. And in the Greek, that the words covet in the Greek text of the New Testament that I just read to you are intertwined with that same Hebrew word. They have close to the same meaning. It was Moses that said in the Old Testament, he said in Exodus 20 and verse 17, thou shalt not covet, there's the word, thy neighbor's house. Thou shalt not covet thy neighbor's wife. Thou shalt not covet thy neighbor's manservants or maidservants or his oxen or his donkeys or anything that your neighbor has. Now that word is a very strong word used in the Hebrew language. And when I looked it up, I wanted to see the difference in this word and the word that the Apostle Paul uses in the Greek text, in 1 Corinthians 12, and I found there was very little difference. The Hebrew word here is used for the word covet. The use for the word covet is the strongest word there is to reveal the word desire. As a matter of fact, how many of you ever had desire? How many of you ever had a holy ambition inside of you? Well, this word covet is even stronger than that. It is even a stronger word than the word lust
Now, lust is a powerful word, which means an unholy desire, an unlawful craving, or a misdirected passion, an unholy zeal. But lust is when a man desires something to the point of having it, to the point of having a heated, hot passion for it. It is an overwhelming feeling that is unquenchable. Haven't you ever heard the term, he's burned with passion? He's so hot that he can't let go of it. As a matter of fact, there's been times in our lives that we've had desire for things where it was just hot and boiling. You couldn't sleep. You couldn't eat. It was on your mind. It was in your heart. You just wanted it. You had to have it. Instead of you possessing it, it almost possessed you. Anybody know what I'm talking about? And yet the Apostle Paul uses that same word to describe this word coveted in our text. The word covet carries desire to a whole nother level. The word covet here actually means more than just hot or boiling or passionate desire, but it means to plan, to scheme, to plot, or to pursue what is desired. That's why that Moses said, hey, don't allow your lust be carried too far to where it's conceived, because if it's conceived, you'll turn into covetousness, and covetousness will set it in order for you to have it, and you'll not be able to stop until you attain it. And this is the exact same word that is used in our text. The word covenant just means to plan, to scheme, to plot. And let me remind you that it was Paul that said, covet earnestly the best gifts. Did you hear what he said? He's telling you to want that more than wanting anything. He's saying, set your mind to it. He said, put your life into motion with it. He said, start seeking it. Start wanting it. Start craving it. Oh, hallelujah. And if we as the body of Christ could ever crave the gifts of the Spirit as the way that we crave other things, oh my, what could God do at the Palace of Praise at this 21st century in 2016? God would turn this place inside out, and we'd have the testimony that we would turn the world upside down. Oh, give him praise in this house. Hallelujah. He even went on, Paul did, in 1 Corinthians 14:39. Wherefore, brethren, covet to prophesy, and forbid not to speak with tongues. He tells us two things there. He said to covet to prophesy. Covet. He's looking out over this congregation, and he's breathing upon it, and he's saying, hey, Bill Marvin, covet to prophesy. Hey, Gary, Mr. So-and-so there, covet to prophesy. He's looking out, Brother Parker, covet to prophesy, and to forbid not to speak with other tongues. Now, the Greek word in the New Testament for covet means to delight in, to look at them as precious, to wish for, to be desirous, or to long for. We are to look after the gifts of the Spirit as precious, as valuable, as a necessity, as a need, as food is a need to sustain our normal life. The gifts of the Spirit is the spiritual food that is necessary for the survival of the spiritual life. Can I have an amen? And he's saying, as you would seek after your own food, as you would desire after the things that's precious, that brings life, that is the way that you are to covet after the gifts. It also carries with it the idea of going after it and pursuing it, just like the Hebrew definition. Covet is an action word that puts desire into action. It means to put into motion. It means to make happen, to go after. I want to tell you, it actually places it in the context that one cannot live without it. It is a burning desire, an unquenchable desire. It's ate you up. Hallelujah. You know what? I'm ate up right now, because I go home and I cry. I get in my van and I cry. I sit in my office at times and I cry. You know what I'm crying about? Because I'm so passionate to see the true workings of Pentecost in the 21st century, to where there's a revival and an awakening and a shaking of this country, to where the evil will not prevail and the evil politicians will crumble and God's Holy Spirit will save our nation. Hallelujah. We are to seek them, according to the Apostle Paul, as if we can't live without them. How many of us actually pursue spiritual gifts like that? How many of us really seek for the spiritual gifts like that? How many of us truly hunger after and crave for the Holy Spirit to empower us and use us in the gifts of the Spirit? I've been convicted of that here lately, to be honest with you. And this is the reason that there's little to none of the gifts working in the body of Christ in this 21st century. There's a lack of passion and zeal and desire for the holy things of God. The Bible makes it clear, does it not, in Matthew 5 and 6? Blessed are those that do hunger and thirst after righteousness, for they're the ones that shall be filled. Who's going to receive the gifts of the Spirit? Those that hunger, those that thirst after it, those that have that point of affection, of desire to seek after. It seems that we can crave and desire just about most anything. We crave, we desire, we burn with passion for worldly things. But when it comes to the Spirit, there's a lack of zeal. There's a lack of desire. There's a lack of passion. We see people becoming desirous of things to the point that they crave. They increase with hot intensity. They boil to the point of desire. They set themselves in motion to obtain that which they want. And we see it happening with cars, with homes, with lands. Nothing wrong with that at times. And just hobbies. And sometimes they even go after unholy things. Sometimes men go after other women's wives. And sometimes wives go after other wives' husbands. And sometimes it's a lust. It's a powerful lust. And sometimes you can see it and you can preach to it and you can go counsel it and you can talk to them, but it doesn't matter. They're bent. It's like the word iniquity in the Hebrew that means to bend after. There's no point of return. You can't turn back because your desire is so strong, it has overtaken you and you're possessed, and it's a driving force that makes you go after it. And God's saying, I want that same kind of intensity in your life for the things of the Spirit. I want it to. There's no point in return. God, I can't stop seeking. God, I can't stop asking. God, I can't keep from pursuing. I'm knocking. I'm seeking. I'm asking. I'm looking. I'm desiring. I'm studying. I'm praying. I'm doing all that I know to do. I made up with this thing. Hallelujah. That's what God's wanting in the body of Christ. The passion for it begins a lot of times of the things that we want to consume us, to the point that we begin to scheme, we begin to plot, we begin to plan, we begin to pursue until that which is desired is obtained. How many times have I ever wanted something and have to scheme it in my mind how to present it to Jenny so that I can get it? So, some of you are laughing. You know what I'm talking about. How many times as a child when I wanted something that somehow to start scheming, plotting, planning, manipulating if necessary, to mom and dad in order to set up my plan to get what I want. Come on. Some of you are looking at me like you're pious. You never do that. You're a liar. And the truth dwelleth not in you. Amen? Because we've all been guilty. There's times that just simple things. A golf club can drive a man crazy sometimes. Come on. A fishing pole. Gotta have it. Gotta have a car. Whatever it is. Can eat you alive, can make you stay awake at nights, come on, make you toss and tumble, and we do it over the natural things. But how many times have we ever been kept awake over spiritual desire until God gives us that which is necessary for our survival? God is creating. I know where he's going with this thing. Hallelujah. So much of the time, our passion fuels and sparks us to action. It sets a flame inside of us that creates an unstoppable intensity of desire. But we have to desire the right. Is it wrong at times to have that towards natural things? No, it's not wrong to dream. It's not wrong to want until it begins to possess you. But in the spiritual realm, God wants you to be so possessed by your spiritual desire that there's a point of no return, because the fuel sparks an inner desire that cannot be stopped, to where you push and you persevere and you keep pushing and you persevere, and no matter what happens and no matter what circumstances come against you and no matter what stands in your way, you stand and you will not be denied until you receive that which is unquenchably driving you and craving you to the point of wanting to obtain. Want it. Gotta have it. Can't live without it. It's a necessity in my life. Paul didn't just use the word covet, but he also used the word earnestly. Wow. How many of us ever get earnest about the things of God? The word earnest in the Greek word, man, this is powerful right here. It means to have warmth for, a hot feeling for, to want, to be jealous over, or to be zealous. Some of you, when you were dating your spouse, do you remember how you desired? How you wanted? Hello? How that you went after, sometimes even in a wrong way. But yet in this passage, it's telling us that we're not only to have a warm feeling, a hot, boiling passion, but he uses some strong words. He uses the word zeal, which is a word within itself, to be zealous. But he also uses the word jealousy. And yet the Bible tells us that jealousy is cruel as the grave, but there is a righteous jealousy. Oh, somebody help me preach right here. It is a jealousy that says, hey, I am jealous of anybody that has it when I have the availability to have it and I don't have it. Come on, somebody help me preach. I gotta have it. I'm jealous over it with a godly jealousy. This is the kind of desire that we are to have for the gifts of the Spirit. We're not to be jealous in the sense that we don't want anyone else to have it. But we're to be jealous in the sense that if Joe has it, and if Sam has it, and if Susie has it, and it's available for me, then I'm going to be jealous, sparked to jealousy, until I receive it for myself. Hallelujah. It's like what God's doing with Israel. The Bible says, and it's going to happen, with everything that's taking place with the Gentiles right now, and Israel watching all the calamity that they're going through, and they're seeing the blessing upon the Gentile nations, it says that God's using that to spark Israel to jealousy. That's what it's doing. And you and I today, when we look out in the body of Christ and we see the manifestation of gifts of the Spirit operating in other people's lives, and if they're not operating in our lives, we are to become jealous in a righteous sense that I got to have what that person just has. It sparks me to jealousy. Come on, somebody help me preach. We are to want and desire these spiritual gifts because Paul made it plain all throughout this chapter that they are necessary and they're needful for the body. Look at verse 31 again. But covet earnestly the best gifts. Why? Why are you to covet earnestly the best gifts? He tells you why. So that I can show you a more excellent way. In other words, it is only by the spiritual gifts that the way to excellence is found in the body of Christ. You want an excellent church? It can't be excellent without the gifts of the Spirit. So many churches are so void of them, and yet they claim to be excellent. There is no excellence outside of the workings of the Spirit of God. Going throughout the body and using the body. Using not just a pastor, that if the pastor and the deacons are the only ones that's used of God, then this is a dictatorship and God's not a dictator. He uses a body to where all members have a part to supply to the working of the kingdom, to where all is important. And that not one other is more important than another. You read it throughout that chapter. He tells you, what good would the body do without a hand? Or what good would a leg do without a foot? And what good would a foot do without a toe? You may be a little toe on a foot, but you got a purpose, and that purpose is necessary for the growth and for the success of the kingdom of God. And I don't have time to preach on that. That is not my message this morning. But I want you to know that gifts provide a better way to live. A more productive, a more fruitful, a more prosperous, a more spiritual way. How many want a prosperous church? A lively church? An exciting church? A mysterious church? Then we got to have the gifts of the Spirit operating in it. Can I have an amen? Without the Spirit, we can do nothing. But it's only through the power of the Spirit that the supernatural manifests itself in power and glory. Only by the Spirit. I want to tell you something. No flesh shall glory in God's presence. It's either going to be spirit or it's going to be nothing. Can I have an amen? It's not according to Zerubbabel. It's not by power nor by might, but by what? By my Spirit saith the Lord of hosts. This is why that Paul said in verse 7 of this chapter, but the manifestation of the Spirit is given to every man to profit withal. Did you hear that? What did the Bible just say? First of all, that the manifestation of the Spirit is given to who? All men, not some men. Not just part of us. Not just an elite group. not just to chosen, not just to a few, but the gift of the Spirit is given to all men to where they can profit with all. There is a profit in the gifts of the Spirit, and they bring blessing to every church body that receives and works in those gifts. A church void of spiritual gifts is like a sailboat that has no wind. It's like a cloud without any rain. It's like a well without any water. When you begin to look between the two verses of our text, you will see a whole chapter devoted to the gifts of the Spirit, 31 verses, and then you'll see them again in another chapter right after that. There are 31 verses in this chapter that speaks of the gifts, their workings, their order, their arrangements, the purpose of them, and the necessity of them. There are 9 gifts of the Spirit that are mentioned in this chapter, and I don't have time to even preach on half of them, but the Lord has kind of laid 2 on my heart for this morning. It's kind of unusual. But among the gifts of the Spirit that are mentioned in our text, the least discussed and taught on in pulpits today is actually the gift of healing and the gift of miracles. And you know why they are? Because those are the ones that really put us to the test. We can explain away the other ones. We can act like we have wisdom. We can act like we have a word of knowledge. We can go through things. But let me tell you something. When a miracle happens, it's got to happen. You can't talk your way out of it. Can I have it? So we want to avoid it. We want to avoid it as if to say, we can't do this. And until you realize you can't do it, you'll never seek for God to help do it through you and by you or in you or whatever you need. And the gifts of healing and the gifts of miracle, the Lord would not allow me to get out of this morning. But listen to me, just because they are not discussed that much in the church is no indicator of their lack of availability and their need to be operating in the church of the 21st century. The lack of their visibility is simply an indicator of an unwillingness on our part as believers to utilize the key that unlocks the storehouse where these gifts are actually contained. We have to realize that they are either for us or they are not for us. They are either for the 21st century church or we are wrong. Some would like to use any lack of visible miracles and the lack of manifestations and healing as an indictment against God to attempt to justify their statement that says this, the days of miracles are over. And then when they say that to a lot of churches and they say, oh, no, they're not. And then they'll say, well, put up the proof. Where are they? Come on, somebody help me preach. But let me say this. Any perceived lack of miraculous activity among the body of Christ today is no indictment against God. God has never changed. He is the same yesterday, today, and forever. And if there is an indictment, it lies before the people of God who have not chosen to utilize the key that unlocks the storehouse of those that contain those gifts. I wish I had time to preach right here. You know, when people refuse to get saved, it doesn't take away the fact that God wants to save. It doesn't take away the fact that God wants all men to become saved and come to the knowledge of truth. He's not willing that any should perish, but all come to repentance. It doesn't take away that he's able to save to the uttermost ever sin, that he liveth to make intercessory for the saints. Amen. When a man don't get saved, that doesn't take away God's ability to save or his desire to save. And let me say, just because people refuse to operate in the gifts of the Spirit does not take away the availability of those gifts for us right here today. The key is coveting earnestly the desired gifts in the time of need. I hope I have time to preach this sermon. If there's ever been a time when the gift of healing and the gift of miracles need to be manifested, it's in the times in which we live. Sickness, famine, disease, plagues, viruses, they're rampant among us. The biggest part of my ministry is chasing sick folk. Come on, somebody help me preach. Some of the busiest things that you do, if you're a good member of this church, is calling and affirming and encouraging people that are sick. It's everywhere. It's in homes. It's in nursing homes. It's in hospitals. It's in the church. It's everywhere you go. There's people with problems and difficulties and diseases and things that they're diagnosing now that they don't even know what they are. Can I have an amen? Most everyone here in this building today has a car that is equipped to get them from one place to another, and it fits their family needs. But let me say this, until you put that key into that car and turn it on, the possibilities of that car getting you to where you're wanting to go and to fulfill your need is impossible. And until we as a body of Christ, by faith, unloose heaven with the key of faith and with a compassionate desire, a covenant desire to see God move in our midst, we'll never be able to unleash heaven and have the needs of our lives met through the gifts of the Spirit. It's that simple. I'm here to tell you that God is a, you don't understand. If you even had insight on this sermon, you'd be doing cartwheels right there throughout this church. You'd be up shouting because I'm telling you he's fixing to turn us inside out, upside down. Brother Zach looked at me a while ago and said, man, we're that close to the threshold this morning, aren't we? And I said, you better know it. More than what you can ever even think. Oh, hallelujah. We're about to, this church, the Palace of Praise in 2016 is about to step over into the supernatural. Hallelujah. God prophesied to us. And he said the first part of this month, if we'll do what's right and seek him and pray and to begin to really watch ourselves and clean ourselves up and to get ourselves presented before him in righteousness, that by the time the end of this year would come, that God would do so many extraordinary things, it would blow our minds that the latter part of this year would be the greatest years of our lives. Hallelujah. He's weeding out doubt. He's weeding out corruption. He's weeding out unrighteousness and people that are stiff-necked. And we're losing some folks because they're stiff-necked. They're not willing to change. And they're coming before God in a haughty and a casual way. And God's weeding them out. And we told you the vision last Sunday night of the church being elevated. And when it was elevated, we was all excited until he turned it on his axis with the front door out. And people started grabbing a hold of everything that they could. And people were falling out the front door. And then when people quit falling out the front door, he put it back on its axis in an elevated position. And then he said, the remnants left, and it's them that I'll pour my glory on it. Hallelujah. Do you not understand that some of you are the remnant? And you're about to see things that you, oh, it's going to blow your mind. If there's ever been a time that we need the supernatural, it's now. The potential of the gifts are to be operated by faith. They're to be operating in our lives, but they're never going to be noticed or detected until we search after them with all of our heart. Paul did not spend his time writing this chapter to the church if it were not possible for every member of the church to be used with the potential gift that actually would profit this body. God spent his whole time sitting there, defining it, telling you how that they operate, what are they used for. All nine gifts, he clarifies all nine of them. It's very simple. I don't know why in the world people read this chapter and can't understand it. Let's define the word miracle for a moment. That's what we're talking about. A miracle, by definition, is a supernatural intervention in the ordinary course of nature. It is a temporary suspension of the accustomed order. In other words, what you're used to, you better watch out because God's about to interrupt it. He's about to send a suddenly along that's going to get you out of your ordinary routines. And then he says it's an interruption of the system of nature as we know it, operated by the force of the Spirit. Aren't you ready for a mysterious move of God to where we just get in here and all of a sudden things take a turn and we're out of the natural realm and we're into the supernatural realm? And things begin to happen, and all of a sudden, you begin to hear people, whoo, did you see that? Or you'll hear somebody say, wow, did you see so-and-so? Wow, did you hear about, oh, wow, did you? Come on, somebody help me preach. You know what I want to hear throughout the Palace of Praise? The wows. Wow, whoa. I want people to be blown away. I want people to not be able to have to come in here and be skeptical. I want them to walk out and say, that's undeniable. What just took place is undeniable. I got a friend who's been in the ministry for 20-some years, and he spoke to me a few years back, and it disheartened me. He said, I've been preaching for 20 years, and I've not seen a bona fide miracle yet, and I don't understand why. And I wanted to say, dear God, he said, have you ever seen one? I said, absolutely. He said, I'm not talking about somebody coming up and saying they got a headache and you pray for them and then they say the headache. I want bona fide proof. I said, I want to tell you, we've got it. And I'm going to get into some of those after a while, but we've got proof of people in this congregation that has an interruption, a divine divinity that came upon the scene and stopped the natural order of process and got involved and brought about the supernatural workings of God. Can I have an amen? I'm a recipient of that. A miracle happens when divinity steps in and intervenes into human affairs. The Greek word for miracles is dynamis. Not dunamis, but dynamis. And it denotes a sudden intervention of almightiness. The working of impelling, staggering wonders or astonishments. Woo! How many's ready for some astonishments? How many's ready for some staggering, impelling wonders? Hallelujah. The outworking of almighty interventions or an explosion of almightiness. That's what it is. However, even though it is a work of divinity, a miracle, yet did you know that God chooses us sometimes to be the vein that he chooses to flow through in order to bring it to pass? Amen? God chooses and uses people through which he flows by his Holy Spirit to bring about holy results. As a matter of fact, in Ephesians 3 and 20, it says, now unto him that's able to do exceedingly, abundantly, above anything that we're even able to ask or think. God's able to do exceedingly, abundantly, above even what your wildest imaginations can even dream up. How? By the power that worketh mightily in us. That's how he's going to do it. Hello? He uses common, ordinary people who have paid the price of commitment. Acts 5 and 12 says, and by the hands of the apostles were many signs and wonders wrought among the people. How amazing it is that human men and women can become instruments in God's hand through which he flows. Oh, hallelujah. I want to be such a person. God, let me be that man. God is seeking here this morning for those today whom he can use for his glory to benefit his people. He's not going to use you if you get lifted up in pride and think it's a working of your own hands. He's not going to do it if you try to steal the glory and think you're really something and showcase it like a circus event. God's only going to do it when you're a humble man or a humble woman and you realize that if anything's done through me, it's done by the grace of God because I'm a nobody and I'm a nothing and I'm broken and I got a contrite spirit and I'm just humble enough to admit that if it's done, it's done by the hand of God and not by the hand of myself. Can I have an amen? And when we get to that place, God begins to move upon people and things begin to happen. God is wanting, desiring to pour out the anointing of the Holy Spirit upon the church to perform miracles. Acts 6 and 8 says, and Stephen, full of faith and power, did great wonders and miracles among the people. The Bible says about Philip, and Philip was just nothing more than a common layman like you and I at times. In Acts 8, verse 5 and 6, then Philip went down to the city of Samaria and preached Christ unto them, and the people gave heed according to the word of Philip by the things in which they seen and they heard. And he said, for unclean spirits crying with loud voices came out of many, and they that were possessed with them were delivered. And he said, and those that had palsies, they were healed, and the lame were healed by Philip. And the Bible even says in Mark 16 and 20, talking about the early disciples, and they went forth and preached everywhere, the Lord working with them, confirming the word with signs and wonders. Amen. You say, well, that was Stephen, and that was Philip, and that was the disciples in the early church. Oh, but listen to Mark chapter 16, verse 17. And these signs shall follow them that believe. In my name they shall speak with new tongues, and they shall cast out devils. And if they drink any deadly thing, it shall not hurt them. And if they lay hands on the sick, they shall recover. That's to the believers. Amen. Listen to what the word says in 1 Corinthians 12. Just a few verses, 8 through 10. I wish I could get them all. For one is given to one individual in the church, one is given the spirit of the word of wisdom. To another, the word of knowledge, but it's done by the same spirit. To another, faith by the same spirit. To another, the gift of healing by the same spirit. To another, the working of miracles. He starts naming the gifts of the spirit. And you know what he says? He may reach over here and give Brother Crutchfield the word of wisdom. He may touch Bob over here and give him the word of knowledge. He'll touch Carolyn, give her the gift of faith. And he'll touch old Bud here, give him the gift of healing. He'll touch old Gary there and give him the working of miracles. But it's all done by the self-same spirit. Amen? That's what he's saying about the church. I'm here to announce, I'm here to proclaim, I'm here to preach, I'm here to testify, I'm here to teach that the working of miracles is still for the church of today. Hebrews 2 and 4 says, God also bearing them witness both with signs and wonders and divers miracles and gifts of the Holy Ghost according to his own will. You've come too late to tell me there's no miracles. I remember a young girl over on 9th and Cedar that came to our church, 4 years old. She'd walk up to the altar with her parents. She had a big knot that protruded way out here like this on one side of her her stomach. And I thought, what in the world? And they said, we've got bad news. We got the diagnosis from our doctor. It is a tumor. It is inoperable. It is stage 4 cancer. And they said that there's nothing that our daughter that can do for my daughter. They're going to do whatever they can, and she's going to die. And we prayed for her. They went ahead and went to St. Louis because their doctor says, you can go, but you're wasting your time. I know they're going to tell you the same thing I just told you. They went to St. Louis, to Barnes Hospital, after we had prayed. They'd done their own test. They'd done their own examinations, and they came out and said, I want you to know that your daughter has stage 4 cancer. Her tumor is the size of a football. It's in a 4-year-old body. It's intertwined with all of her intestines. There's nothing that we can do. We will try to go in and try to remove it to the best of our ability to relieve some pressure. It'll help her in her pain. But ultimately, your daughter's going to die. The Holy Spirit spoke to me and said, get John Sells and go to St. Louis and pray for that girl a second time. We got in the car and we went up there and we walked in the door. John can verify it. We walked in and the Holy Ghost hit as soon as we got in there. And they looked at us and they were so overwhelmed that the preacher from, because they've only visited the church a couple of times. And I walked in, I said, before you say anything, I want to tell you the Holy Spirit wants us to pray for your daughter because your daughter's going to be healed. And that dad looked at me as if to say, why are you giving me such false hope? We prayed right there in that room. We didn't even get to pray for the girl. The doctors come out after about a 6 or 8 hour surgery, I don't remember how many hours, and said, a miracle has transpired. Said, we don't understand. And said, what do you mean? Said, we opened her up and the tumor just rolled out and fell out on the table. And I want to tell you, that little 4-year-old girl is still alive today. Don't tell me my God doesn't bring healing. Don't tell me that God doesn't heal. I got a brother here, had stage 4 brain cancer some 5-6 years ago, or however how long it's been, sitting right there on that front seat. God spoke to me and God said, you got to confess it before this congregation. And I said, oh God, what happens if I confess it? Nothing happens. He said, do you believe or don't you believe? I said, confess it to this congregation. I confessed it to this congregation and your worship and your praise. I want to tell you, that's been almost 5-6 years, however how long it's been. My brother's right here today, cancer free from stage 4 cancer. Don't tell me my God isn't a God of deliverance. Garrett Calhoun gave his testimony 2 weeks ago. I remember the night that we got the call and said he had throat cancer and there was no surgeon that would touch it. There's only one in the world that would even look at it, and he probably won't be able to do the surgery. And said, it looks like that Greg's life's over. That's the report I got. And I got home and I was praying for him, and the Holy Spirit said, you go tell Greg. You tell him that he shall not die, but he shall live. This is not a disease or a sickness unto death. He'll go through some things. He'll go through some problems, but you go tell him what I'm telling you. And I said, yes, sir. Josh Reasons calls me. And Josh says, the Holy Ghost has been stirring my spirit. I said, what's about? He says, it's about Greg. I want to tell you, the Lord's telling me, it's not a disease unto death. It's not a sickness unto death. That Greg's going to be all right. I said, you need to go with me. For out of the mouth of 2 witnesses, everything shall be established. We walked into his house with boldness and we looked him eyeball to eyeball and said, we understand your diagnosis. We understand what the bad report you got. We understand how serious it is. We understand the C word cancer. We understand the death sentence that's passed upon you. But I'm here to tell you what the word of the Lord stirred in my spirit. And today, Greg Calhoun sitting in this service, free, cancer free. Stand to the Lord and give him praise. Hallelujah. You can be seated. You see, I can give you miracle after miracle, what Jesus done and Paul done and what Silas done and all of that, but I'm telling you about miracles that's happening today. At the beginning of my ministry, God showed me a long time ago. God confirms your calling sometimes with a miracle. I remember the first miracle, bona fide miracle that ever I seen miracles by the working of my pastor's hands. But never was I used in where I seen a bona fide miracle by me laying on hands by myself somewhere. Got a call from an older lady. It's her daughter that called me. Said, Mom's in terrible shape. She's just crying. Said, we can't take it anymore. Her feet is hurting so bad. Could you come and pray for her? I've told this story. I'm going to tell it again. I don't know. I'm somewhere around 19 years of age. I get up in my car. And I go down to an old side trailer house, knock on the door. Ann Powell comes to the door. A heavyset lady, close to 400 pounds. She lives in an old 1950-some trailer house. The floors are really saggy. When you walk, it just shakes. It's an older home. We walk into the side door. I said, where's your mom? And she said, she's in her regular place, because I visited them pretty regular. I prayed for them often. I started to walk down the hallway, and Ann said, wait before you go. She started crying. She said, I can't hardly go. And I said, what's wrong, Ann? She said, my back's killing me. She said, I've been lifting Mom in the tub. I've been lifting her out of the tub. I've been putting her into bed. I've been taking her out of the bed. I pick her up, put her at the dinner table. Take her away from the dinner table, put her back in her wheelchair. She said, I can't do it no more. And she's crying. She said, I don't know what I'm going to do. They're very poor people. And I just reached around there, put my hand on her back and started praying, and she started jumping. And I thought for sure both of us was going through the floor of that trailer. The whole house began to rattle. Vera's in the other room, and her voice is real soft. What's going on in there? And Ann's just shouting, and she got totally healed right then. Bam, just like that. I started shouting. I thought, oh, God, you used me. I felt so good. And I said, where's Vera? I was high-stepping it in there, and I'm going to lay hands on this woman. She's going to get up, and she's going to walk. And I walked in as a zealous 19-year-old boy, and I walked up, and there she sat in her chair. She had a big white basin about the size of a wash tub, both feet in it. Her ankles were about the small end of a baseball bat, and her feet were bigger than a football, and they had busted open. There was blood and infection and yellow stuff pouring out of her feet and green stuff. It stunk so bad I couldn't even hardly stand the smell. And she had both feet in that container. And there was probably 3 or 4 inches of liquid of just nothing but blood and infection and just horrible stuff. And the Lord spoke to me. All of a sudden, he took my excitement out of my experience. He said, lay your hands on her feet. I said, oh, God. I'm just being human here. I turned and I looked at the television, and Jimmy Swaggart was sitting there, and he was preaching. I said, just give Jimmy Swaggart a word. I'll give it to him. Let him just speak over that television. Vera, be healed in Jesus' name, and I'll accept that. God said, I said, lay your hands on her feet. I just closed my eyes. I said, yes, Lord. And I knelt down, and the stench was so bad, I upchucked. I'm being honest. It's horrible. I closed my eyes. And right when I started to touch her feet, I thought, I hope her feet's there. And I opened my eyes to see where her feet was at. And my hands were right over them, and I just touched them. And what I did, whoom, they were made whole right before my eyes. Don't tell me my God don't do miracles. Matter of fact, I remember Sister Merriman, 9th and Cedar. The Lord gave me a word of wisdom, a word of knowledge, and said, there's somebody here with a backbone that's decaying. They got a decay in their backbone about the size of a peanut. That's what I said. I said, the Lord said, if you'll come up here, God will heal you. And Sister Merriman jumped up about 5 or 6 seats back, jumped up and ran to the altar, weeping and crying. I said, Sister Merriman, is it you? She said, yes. And me and Jesse just got back from Jonesboro Hospital. And this is what they told me. They told me that I got a decay in my backbone about the size of a peanut. and that it was going to get worse because they couldn't do anything about it because it's around the nervous system. And if they tried to touch it, I'd be paralyzed for life. And said, I've got a few good years, but my bones are going to deteriorate. That's going to get worse and worse, and I'm going to become paralyzed over a period of time. We laid our hands on her, and before long, she went out in the spirit. And to let me tell you something, folks, when she went back to the doctor, there was no more decay in the backbone. There was no more the size of a peanut. God had totally healed her. You want me to keep going? Oh, I could just tell you miracle after miracle. Sister Midge Edgar, I tell you, the McGarity family was there. They can verify. She went up to have brain surgery. Going to have tumors removed from her brain. We got there, and they took her back, and they told us it'll take a little while. We got to drill holes, and we're going to go in and get the tumors and bring them out. We're all upset. They go in to take pictures, had to start the surgery, and was gone about less than 5 minutes. And they come into the room and said, we got to talk to the family. And I thought, oh, no. What in the world has happened? They've been only in there for 5 minutes. Something's went wrong. We all braced ourselves, and the doctor come in, and he was stuttering around, and he was kicking around, and I'm so sorry, and tears was in his eyes, and finally we thought, what? I mean, it took forever for him to finally get it out. We thought, man, he's fixing to give us some bad news. And finally he said, I want you to know we have not misdiagnosed your sister. Here's the x-rays, right here's the tumor. Said, but we, before we drilled the holes, we had to take another x-ray because them tumors have a tendency to roll the kind they are, and we got to get right over it in order to get it out. Said, when we took the x-rays, they're gone. They're not there. Don't tell me my God doesn't heal. I remember one time John Sales was in 9th and Cedar Church. Didn't let anybody know it, not even me. Didn't let his family know about it. Because of his lung disease, they had him on a certain kind of a medication. And the medication, one of the side effects, it would destroy your liver. And John was having liver problems and was telling nobody about it. Merrill Porter. Brother Porter, you here this morning? Where you at, Brother Porter? You usually are here. Merrill Porter stood up in that service and said, Brother Miller, I feel like the Holy Ghost has spoken to me. There's somebody here that's got liver problems. And if they'll come up to the altar, God will heal them. All of a sudden, John was the first one up, and he ran to the altar. I said, John, is it you? And he said, yeah. I didn't tell nobody, but the medication I'm on has destroyed my liver, and I'm jaundiced, and I'm having problems, and already the doctor said my liver is in trouble. We prayed for that man that day. God totally healed him, and he's never had a liver problem since. Can I have an amen? You know, God does things even to the smallest degree, and I'll quit here in a minute. I could go on. You say, wow, we forgot all about these miracles. We do forget about them. I remember Tom Roark having a surgery, and the kind of surgery that he had, for some strange reason, I don't know why it's like that, but they said, you'll lose your big toe. I said, what do you mean? I mean, it wasn't even on his toe. It was on his pancreas or something, if I remember correctly. He said, but you're going to lose your big toe. 99% of all the people who have this surgery, they lose their big toe. Said, you're going to lose it. A few days after the surgery, that toe turned black and sore. Well, he's going to lose his toe. He comes home, and I hear word about it. And the Holy Spirit said, you go pray for Tom. I get up. I go to the house, and Barbara's there. I walk in. Tom's sitting on the couch. Tom, how you doing? Come check on you. I said, Tom, I got to tell you something. The Holy Spirit told me to come pray for you. You're not going to lose your toe. He kind of looked at me, really? I said, yeah. We prayed. Nothing happened at that moment. I walked out, and Barbara told me later that Tom said, that preacher can say whatever he wants, but it's my toe. I want to tell you, he didn't lose his toe. Are you listening to me? God cares about your toe. That's why Jesus said, the Spirit of the Lord God is upon me. Because he's anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor. He sent me to preach deliverance to the captive, the covering of the sight to the blind, to set at liberty them that are bruised, and to preach the acceptable year of the Lord. That's why that Acts 10:38 said how that God anointed Jesus Christ of Nazareth with the Holy Ghost and with power, who went around doing good and healing all of them that was oppressed of the devil, for God was with him. That's why that John said that this is the reason the Son of God was manifested, that he might destroy the works of the devil. And Isaiah said he was wounded for our transgressions, he was bruised for our iniquity, and the chastisement of our peace was upon him, and through his stripes were healed.
Would you stand with me this morning? Hallelujah. If you're crazy enough to believe for a miracle, I'm crazy enough to agree with you. Amen. I'm here to tell you that God, signs and wonders and divers miracles and gifts of the Holy Spirit are going to start flowing in the church. But we got to covet earnestly the best of gifts. We got to desire it with everything that's within a hot, intense, burning desire to want it, to see it. Lord, I can't live without it. Don't be praying for me to receive it. Pray for yourself to receive it. Pray for me too. Pray for all of us that we all receive it. I don't know, but I know that there's people that's so afflicted in this body. So many diseases. The amount of diseases that ticks are giving people. Is Jessica here this morning? She's not here this morning. I wish she is here. Kathy, come up here and stand in for her. Her daughter got a tick bite. And because of that tick bite, she can't eat anything that's meat that's four-footed. Cows, deer, don't matter what it is. If it's got four hoofs, she can't eat it because it'll kill her. And I want to tell you, life ain't grand if you can't eat a T-bone. I'm serious. God wants to heal her. Yes, Teresa Persons here this morning. She's had a tick bite. She's on my mind. There's so many people on my mind. Sicknesses, diseases, infirmities, afflictions. Come on, somebody help me preach. From diabetes, it's out of control. I've never seen so many with cancer in my life. Never in my life have I seen so many people with cancer. Never in my life have I seen so many people battling for their health. Some say, well, it's the way that we eat. It's the kind of diet. It's the lack of exercise. Some of that may be true, but God still cares. I'm telling you, God still cares. Brother Marvin, do you believe in miracles? You believe that God can heal? I want you and Sister Louise to be a prayer partner and come up here with me. Randy, do you believe? Zach, do you believe? I want y'all to be a prayer partner and come up here with me. Jenny, I want you to come with me. You're my prayer partner today. Holy Spirit. Not yet, what you saying? Holy Spirit. There's something heavy going on right now in this congregation. We got people right now, some is wanting to keep it private, but we got people that are hanging on by a thread. We got people that's diagnosed that won't even tell the church what they're diagnosed with. Not just one, but many, because they're not wanting any kind of doubt or any kind of fear to grab a hold of them. We got young ladies and young men with venereal disease that they got as teenagers. And they're ashamed to even say that they need prayer. They don't even have to tell us what it is. I'm telling you, there's somebody here with that disease that God's wanting to take away. It may have been a mistake. It may have been a consequence. But God is gracious and God can heal. Are you listening? Hallelujah. Holy Spirit, have your way. If you're sick here this morning, you got a problem in your life that needs attention, a supernatural intervention of God, I want this teams, and we're going to, as the Lord lays it on my heart, I'll get other teams up here to help me pray. We're going to lay hands upon you, and we're going to believe for the intervention of God to fall upon the gifts of the Spirit and the intervention of God to fall upon the people that lay hands upon you, that you'll be healed. If you're sick and afflicted right here this morning, I want y'all to turn around, those of you that I've called. Lay hands right here upon these two. She's standing in for Teresa Persons. She's standing in for Jessica Gray. They both got a disease that's been afflicted to them by a tick bite. And in the name of Jesus right now, they can be healed.
Is there any others that need to be healed? I want you to come right now in Jesus' name. If you want to stand in for somebody, I know that Sister Carolyn is. I know it's serious. Is there anybody? Anybody else? Holy Spirit. Hold on. Josh, grab you a prayer partner. Grab you a prayer partner. Holy Spirit. Look at this. God's about to heal a lot of Jane Rushing in the name of Jesus right now. God loves you. You've been beat down. You're not only physically ill, you're mentally ill because the enemy has given you a heyday in your mind. And the devil's a liar. And in the name of Jesus, he's going to heal you mentally first, psychologically and emotionally. Be healed in mind. Be free in mind. You can't believe in divine healing until you get emotionally stable and emotionally healed by the power and the anointing of the Holy Ghost. There it is. Jen, there it is. There it is. Start walking. Start going. Don't y'all leave till somebody lays hands on you. Don't y'all leave until somebody lays hands on you. We're going to get around to you. You be patient with us. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Holy Spirit. Holy Spirit right now. In the name of Jesus Christ. Jimmy, I ask them, get you a prayer partner. Get up here and help us pray. Holy Spirit. Melody, get you a prayer partner. We got to have some prayer warriors that know how to pray. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus.